thank everybody for coming, and you know, I guess we're going to open it up to questions in just a second. I appreciate all the people from, I guess we've got some people here from both sides of the aisle, but we surely got a real statement from the Democrats that are here, and I appreciate their, as I've said before, I mean, it takes real courage for them to stand up, being a minority party today, and stand up and say, we're going to lay aside our Democrat side, and we're going to be West Virginians first. You've got to give them some real kudos for their courage, because, you know, in a situation when you're in the minority, and you may have to do some terrible taboo of raising taxes, it takes real courage. But they know, as I know, there is only one way out of this. And it's not raising taxes, it's just plotting a course to recovery. And that's what we've done. But I can go on and on and on, but the net of the whole thing is where I think we are today is just this. We've had all kinds of discussions, and we got right to the altar. I mean, right to the altar. And we basically, and you know, I'm surely not going to cast stones in any way, but the net of the whole thing was we got right to the altar, and we couldn't make a decision. We needed to go to a vote. The decision all centered around the possibility of raising the consumer sales tax a quarter of a penny. A quarter of a penny. Or, if you didn't want to do that, we lowered the cigarette tax down and lowered the sweet soda drinks down, and we came down to 2 pennies on every can of soda drinks, and I think it was 15 cents on the cigarettes. Now, you could have gone either way. It didn't matter to me. A quarter of a penny or go the other way. All the other stuff, I think we agreed to. I mean, you know, pretty much. You know, and basically what that involved was we gave in to things that they wanted as far as cuts. And they amounted to, with what we had already proposed, $55 million or $50 million?
55.
You know, we retained the teacher's pay raise. We went along with the 2% continuing cuts that continued on. You know, there are some slight cuts that we don't think are cutting into the bone as far as DHHR, you know, basically things that we feel like are not matching federal dollars and everything that can't hurt us terribly bad. You know, so we've tried to work together. I give kudos to the Democrats, and I also give kudos to the people that are trying to get there on the other side. The net of the whole thing is, you know, we can throw the baby out with the dishwater and end up starting all over, and it would be catastrophic to our state and to all of us. And so we were right at the altar. We couldn't get a vote, and we couldn't get a decision. It surely didn't come from the Dems, but the Republicans couldn't decide what to do. And then they left, and that was last night. And so there's no need in us as the legislators, or as myself as the governor, to sit down here and continue down here and extend the session, and there's just no need. There's just no need. We need to do our job, vote, and go home. That's what we need to do. So so I'll answer any question that you...
Can you pinpoint where exactly the breakdown in communications and negotiations came?
Well, it's not a breakdown in communication that I, from our side, in any way, shape, form, or fashion. The decision is just this simple. You know, I mean, none of us, I don't want to make light of this, nobody wants to see any tax increase. Nobody wants to see that. But I ask you the simple question, as I asked yesterday at WVU. You find me one person, one West Virginian, that's not willing to pay a penny for every $4 that they spend. A penny. And that person could have the option of closing that senior center, closing that park, state park, cutting down on Promise Scholarship, or closing Concord College. You find me one person, good West Virginian, who would say, well, I'd rather do that than I would pay a penny on $4. You can't find one. And that's how unreasonable this guy is. That's all that had to be done. That's it. Change the sales tax from 6 to 6.25, and we were done. We were done. And if you don't want to attack tobacco, and you don't want to attack soft drinks, which I would do in a second, and leave the sales tax at 6%, I'd do it in a second. If you don't want to do that, it was as simple as a quarter of a penny. That's where we broke down.
Senator, are you still opposed to the proposals out there to lower income tax and raise consumer sales tax?
Who's that? Well, Phil, listen. I think the lowering of our state income tax is something that we should all strive to try to pull off. In fact, I think we ought to try to eliminate it. But here's the deal. That's step 2 or 3 in the process. You've got to get this state jump started and going somewhere. And the patient is lying dead in intensive care today, and that would be jumping the patient up and saying, we're taking you straight to the Olympics. Well, if you do that, our numbers show that there are catastrophic results. The math shows you may awaken to a $1 billion hole in the bucket. You know, you could actually go into no man's land. And the other bad part about this is just this. And I want everybody to hear this. If tomorrow you could eradicate the income tax and put a consumer sales tax on and put it on at 8 or 10%, and charge everybody across the board on food and everything coming or going, who's going to pay? Who's going to carry the burden? The people. The average everyday Joe is going to carry the burden. And who's going to get off scot-free? Jim Justice, the rich guy. You know, you're putting all the burden on the average everyday guy, and you're giving Jim Justice a break. I don't think it's right.
Governor, what's the plan going forward? Have talks broken off, or do you have more negotiations scheduled? What's the time frame?
Surely they haven't broken off from our side. You know, you've got so many Republicans that are just begging the leadership and saying, we just want to vote. We just want to vote. And you've got these great Democrats that are standing here all in unison and saying, we're ready to go. We're ready to throw the party to the side, not in a trash can, just throw it to the side and be great West Virginians. We got to vote. That's what we need to do. Do our job. Vote. You know, and I think we'll get this done, and we'll have jump-started this state, and we'll have done something that every last one of us, when we lay to our rest on our last day, are going to know that you did something really good. It's not that it's Jim Justice's idea. It's the right idea. I guarantee you, it's the right way to go.
Vote on what? What piece of legislation is out there to vote on?
Well, I, you know, I mean, we, it surely had to be crafted into a piece of legislation.
Crossover note being yesterday and no vote being taken, there's vehicles, as they say in the legislative world, where the entirety of this plan can just simply be put in there and embedded in there on the House side through the House Finance Committee. You can put all the conversations that we were working on right in there. So it's not a bill per se, it would be a bill to be generated or amended into legislation that's currently available for that purpose. So there's a very easy, clear pathway forward. Could do it today.
So, Governor, are you saying that if the legislature passes a budget that does not include one of these two things, quarter cent sales tax or the tax on soda and cigarettes, that you'll veto that budget?
Well, not necessarily. What I'm saying is all the work that went in to leaving the teachers' pay raise, to eliminating things that we eliminate, go along with the 2% across the board cuts, and all the work that went in, we were right at the point in time where I said, people, if you polled your caucus and said, raise your hand if you were to vote for a quarter of a percent increase in sales tax, and we put that into a bill and put it on the floor and voted, we'd have passed it. Even if we put on the floor and voted on the cigarette and the soft drink tax, and left the sales tax at 6%, we'd have passed it. But we couldn't get it to the floor. Now, I'm not going to say, well, it has to be this way or I'm going to veto it. All I'm going to say is it has to be, the philosophy has to be, you cannot paralyze our state and cut things that are imperative to our state and me not veto it. And we've got to find a pathway out of this that gives us hope and prosperity to get rid of the drugs, to change education, to do the right things without hurting our people and constricting more. It's as simple as that. You know, it is as simple as just this. You can do this, and I've said it 1,000 times. Ask yourself this question. No matter what's on the floor, ask yourself, if we do that, are more people going to come or are more people going to leave? And if the answer is more people are going to leave, I'm going to veto it.
Just so we're clear on this, how much revenue does the sales tax increase, the sugary drink tax, and the cigarette tax proposal collectively, how much would it generate?
Now, we don't need them both.
Okay.
We only need one. We don't need the sales tax, a quarter of a percent, and the cigarettes and the soft drinks. You just need one, and each one of them brings in about $45 million. The cigarettes and the soda tax together is going to be about $45 million, and the quarter of a cent on sales tax is going to be about $45
million.
That's how far you're apart from being done, $45
million. The Senate the other day made a big display of voting down a number of your initial tax increases. What did you make of all that on the Senate floor the other day?
You know, Phil, I'm not going to throw off on anything. I think the whole thing is, you know, people are just trying to, you know, make their point, grandstand, whatever it may be, you know, but ultimately, at the end of the day, we got awfully, awfully, awfully close. And I hope to goodness that cool heads, I've said it many times, there's no need in either side standing and beating your chest. Now's when cool heads need to think, be smart, have wisdom, work together, and finish this up.
The Senate did approve your gas tax. Are you getting any assurance from the House that they're going to take it up and pass it as well? Where does that stand?
Look, I've said it a million times. This is a two-sided animal. You got the side over here that's saying you can't cripple and you've got to balance the budget. And the side over here that says immediate jobs, 48,000 immediate jobs and everything. But I truly believe both sides need to come together. Both sides need to come together all at the same time. You know, I think the Senate passed the roadside like 34-0 or something like that. You know, the House needs to do the same thing. Now, you would be a dumb bunny if you don't think that that all this will go together, you know, and really help our state. I mean, that's just all there is to it.
You said there was...
See, I shouldn't have said that. it just happens. I mean, that's all there is to it. I'm just Jim. I mean, that's the way I talk.
Here come a walrus comments.
I mean, that's right. You know, us bears and walruses screw up every now and then.
How are you going to start talking to the Senate about the budget?
I'm sorry?
The Senate so far has not apparently been involved, at least Senate Republicans, in the budget process with negotiations with the administration. When do they come in?
Well, now they have. We've talked several different times and everything, you know, but at the same time, I mean, you know, we started down this path with the House and everything, and we felt like we had a real live budget here. I mean, we had a real live shot, you know, and everything. I think if we get the House budget passed and everything, then we can go back to the Senate and we can make real progress. So.
Governor, I know it's not a budgetary issue, but it's more of an issue of what the people want. Polls show overwhelmingly that people of the state want medical marijuana. The Senate passed it by a huge margin last night. Do you think the House should take it up too?
Well, I'm going to say this. You know, I'm dialed in wholeheartedly to the budget. I'm not dodging the question. I've said it over and over. I would be an advocate of medical marijuana. And the reason I would is just this. I don't think any of us, if we had a loved one at home and Doc said that it could help, why in the world are we standing in the way? I mean, now, I would be an absolute opponent to legalizing marijuana because we have got such a drug epidemic in this state that absolutely we need to get our act together before we add another component to the problem. Or to the table.
You said there was some room for agreement on cuts, like to the DHHR. Can you elaborate what those cuts are?
I'll let Nick do that.
Yes, some of the budget that's out there, not in addition to the 2% continuation of the Governor Tolman's cuts, there are some cuts. There's about $4 million worth of cuts. They are not Medicaid match funds. Bill Crouch at DHHR has looked them over. Just they're pretty public. The largest one is to the smoking cessation program, which is $3 million something out of $4 million, and the rest are $150 here, $150 there, and that sort of thing.
So would you sign?
I'm sorry, you were trying to ask that. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry if you asked this, if you answered this before, but would you sign Senate Bill 609, the one that would automatically raise property taxes for all counties to make up for a $79 million cut to public education?
Let me say this, you know, I think that passed the Senate a really, really close vote. And you know, to give you, you know, I don't dodge any question, but to give you a real answer and everything, I'm going to have to do a little more digging on that because it seems harmless, but there's got to be more to it than what I know right now, and I need to do some more digging on that.
Nick, where's the other $51 million cuts then?
Well, the 20 million of that's in the original cuts that the governor had proposed when we presented the budget initially. And some of those, you know, we restored because of the, about 3 million we restored for the benefit of public television, public broadcasting. And the other $20 million, roughly, are the 2% cuts across the board, 2% cuts that have been made by Governor Tolman as he left the administration. So that 2% cut's just pervasive, and it's everywhere. And so that's where the $40 million is. And then you've got the cuts that we just mentioned from DHHR. There was an additional cut to public education, a part of that $15 million. There was a cut to education in the arts, about $5 million. Let me give it to you. There was a cut to DHHR was $4.3 million. The cuts to the education in the arts was $5.2 million. There's a small cut to the Department of Commerce.
DMAPS.
Yeah, DMAPS was a was a continuation of the cuts from Tomlin, but there's some cuts in DMAPs, and again, they're spread around over there, so it's hard to, the largest one being 3.7 in corrections, and then there were smaller cuts running through some, like, different spots. This is the information, the cuts that was provided to us by the Finance Committee of the House, and our folks don't have those down line item because we didn't get them by line item, so we've got them kind of these bunches, or tranches, as they say in the bottom line.
Where are we on Save Our State infrastructure?
We're 20 million. 20 million.
That's another cut I might add. Governor Bridges asked for.
Originally we were 105. I reduced it to 35. I reduced it to 70 million, and we cut it another 15.
You're talking about the funds being the Department of Commerce,
right?
Not the infrastructure planning. Those are two different.
No, no. This is just funds, this is funds to go out and market and promote West Virginia, upgrade a commercial site, attract business to our state, and do the things that we're way, way, way behind the curve with all the other states.
Down in the weeds, I heard something about an end use tax that was on the table yesterday. Is that something that was part of discussions?
Yeah, just the expansion of your...
Yeah, it's a sales tax expansion. People call, they always think in terms of consumer sales taxes. There are business sales taxes also. And I applaud the Republican leadership. The governor had asked for what we call the CAT tax, the commercial activity tax. And in lieu of that, the recommendation the conversation that came out of the leadership at the House, Republican leadership, was eliminate that, but instead, take away some of the exemptions on business-to-business transactions. And that's, I think, called in the tax language a direct use exemption. If you eliminate the direct use exemption, then the sales tax is applied to a broader base, not just Coca-Cola and pop, but also to things that businesses may buy for their use that currently are exempt. So we have actually applauded the Republican leadership. They thought it was appropriate, as the governor said, the cuts come from government. The people would come up with the additional quarter in sales tax, and business gets a real opportunity to participate by having some of their transactions that were formerly exempt being subject to sales tax. That's the direct use.
Was that a tripping point yesterday also? Was that something people...
They proposed it. We thought it was wonderful.
Okay. Let me just say this. It goes back, I keep going back to the same word, philosophy. You see, I really believe that the wealthy have got to step up and do something, you know. Now, what my proposal was $500 if you make more than 200 grand, and $750 if you make more than 250, and $1,000 if you make more than 300,000. For crying out loud, if you're making more than $300,000 in the state of West Virginia, paying $1,000 is nothing. But the average everyday guy turns and looks back, and the optics of that are good and healthy for all of us. The other part of the leg is I think the businesses need to participate. We don't need to lay all this burden right in the laps of the people. And the other thing is our people are going to have to participate a little bit, and then our government is going to have to cut as much waste as we can possibly stand. I don't want to cut any more than we've already proposed in the beginning. But you can take a little bit of this out and it not hurt bad. The 2% across the board, if I had my way, I wouldn't go along with it. But you've got to understand, everybody said over and over, you know, justice won't compromise on stuff. Well, justice is sitting here telling you we have to compromise on things to get to where we want to get to. That's what we're trying to do.
Just trying to make sure the math all adds up here, since the things have changed a lot. So 45 million from either the sales tax increase or the soda and cigarette taxes. We were at a shortfall of 450 million, I believe. Where did we make up that difference? Is it through cuts or reductions in your original proposals or all of the above?
Well, there's stuff all over it now. It's a big, big, big target. But net of the whole thing is, you know, we got down to 0.25% for the cigarettes and for the soda pop. But it's It's too complex to go through every little tweak.
The House Finance Committee moved the teacher pay raise out of the big education bill to another bill to jail. And part of that deal eliminates OEPA, recess, and I think maybe the thinking there was to try to save some money for the teacher pay raise. So I'm asking, do you still support eliminating OEPA and recess now that the teacher pay raise is out of that bill?
Well, it's more complicated now. You know, let me just say this. Here's what I've stood on. I think, and this is a get right to your question, I think we ought to support our veterans. We absolutely ought to exempt our veterans retirement from state income tax. We've got to completely revamp education. We are so top heavy as far as the bureaucrats that are looking at everything, and we're testing our kids to death, and we know we're dead last, we've got to change it. We absolutely have got to pay our teachers more money because we don't have 700 classrooms that have a teacher. You know, so am I in favor of eliminating, Reese's have done great work in a lot of ways, don't get me wrong, but there has to be a better mousetrap than what we're doing. Because what we're doing ain't working. That's all there is to it. We can measure being dead last. It ain't working. And so we gotta figure out something that will make it work. Education needs to be the centerpiece of everything we do. You see, at the end of the rainbow, what have I tried to deliver you? I've tried to deliver you goodness for the vets, a real change in education, a pathway as far as the economics of the whole thing, a pathway that doesn't hurt or cut into our bone and kill us, and a pathway to make us stable, and a pathway to give us hope and go somewhere, and a pathway that eradicates the drugs. Now, that's what I've proposed and I'm trying to deliver for you. You know, I've said it from the very beginning, and I hope now everybody understands and everybody gets it. There's a real, real pathway here that we can really do some really good stuff. I gotta go. Thank y'all.
Thank you.